Hello, esteemed master and practical class members. Today, I would like to share a real clinical case that highlights a common challenge in shoulder evaluation, a discrepancy between imaging findings and passive range of motion testing. In this episode, we will consider and learn how to address situations where imaging findings and physical exam results do not match, and we will review the details of the passive range of motion test, step by step. The patient is a 45-year-old male who came in with right shoulder pain. He reported the pain had recently recurred, especially during overhead reaching, and described a deep, aching pain in the anterior shoulder. Now, regarding his past medical history, last year, he began to feel mild discomfort in that shoulder. Then, in April 2024, he visited a major orthopedic hospital. There, based on an MRI, surgery was recommended. He received a steroid injection, and the symptoms improved for a year. However, within 2 weeks, the pain returned, more intense. He returned to the same hospital, and again, surgery was recommended, still based on the previous imaging, with no new physical assessment. When the patient visited our clinic, I began by reviewing his MRI findings, followed by a full clinical examination and an ultrasound scan. Let me walk you through the clinical examination first, as that is where the real key to this case lies. On exam, his pain score was 6 out of 10 on the visual analog scale. Then passive range of motion was measured, and here are the results. Abduction was limited to just 45 degrees. External rotation, measured at 45 degrees of abduction, was also restricted to 45 degrees. When testing internal rotation, his hand could only reach the gluteal region. Now, here is what truly stood out: in all directions, a bony, hard end feel was observed. This was not a soft or elastic stop, as seen with muscular resistance, but a firm, mechanical block that followed a capsular pattern of limitation. This kind of restriction does not behave like a fresh rotator cuff tear. This pattern is classic adhesive capsulitis. So, even though the MRI showed a partial tear, the findings from manual examination indicated capsular stiffness, not a rotator cuff tear. Let me now demonstrate the MRI findings of the right shoulder. We're looking at a coronal T2 weighted image, focused on the rotator cuff tear region. Here, the acromion can be seen at the top, and just below that, the humeral head. Now, if you look closely at this area, the bright signal intensity observed at the insertional footprint on the bursal side, this indicates an abrupt tendon tear at the anterior portion of the supraspinatus. However, no signal intensity change in adjacent bone or tendon was present. If signal intensity change is not found nearby, the cuff tear cannot be confirmed as the cause of pain. As we scroll posteriorly, increased signal intensity is noted within the supraspinatus tendon, but without a clear full thickness defect. This pattern suggests tendinosis or degeneration, rather than a well-defined tear. Going further to the mid and posterior supraspinatus, the signal becomes diffusely increased, but again, there's no definite tear area in the middle or posterior segments of the tendon. Based on the previous evaluation from late April, there was evidence of tendinosis, increased signal change, mild subacromial bursitis, and a footprint bursal side tear of the anterior supraspinatus. Now, let's move to the sagittal scan. We're starting at the peripheral area, where the supraspinatus tendon can be seen both posteriorly and anteriorly, as well as the subscapularis tendon. Look closely at the white, bright area. This is a defect located in the anterior aspect of the supraspinatus tendon, which correlates with the bursal-sided tear seen earlier in the coronal image. As the scan scrolls more medially, diffuse swelling and increased signal intensity are noticeable throughout the tendon body, which is consistent with tendinosis. There is also mild subdeltoid bursitis, and an increased signal in the lateral portion of the coracohumeral ligament. Although the coracohumeral ligament was studied in adhesive capsulitis earlier, no definite signal changes were observed in the central part of the ligament. There is only mild peripheral signal alteration, which is insufficient to confirm adhesive capsulitis. So, based on this MRI alone, adhesive capsulitis cannot be definitively diagnosed. However, these subtle findings, like inflammation or early injury of the coracohumeral ligament, may progress over time. They may result in scarring or fibrosis, which is commonly seen in adhesive capsulitis in later stages. This area here shows fluid signal intensity at the surface of the coracohumeral ligament on its lateral side. As the sagittal images are assessed, attention should be paid to the biceps pulley complex. Even with minimal signal changes, this area can be a major source of pain in many cases, so it should not be overlooked. Now, let's return to the coronal scan to look at the inferior capsule. Here, no increased signal intensity or obvious thickening of the inferior capsule is observed, findings that are often present in adhesive capsulitis. However, there is a ganglion formation at the scapular attachment of the anterior capsular region. Now, let's move on to the axial scan, which shows the region corresponding to that ganglion. The view is now of the lower edge of the articular surface of the scapular bone. Here is the humeral head, this is the scapula, and this is the subscapularis muscle. Look at this area, high signal intensity can be seen on the outer side of the anterior labral attachment. As the scan scrolls upward to follow the anterior labrum, abnormally increased signal intensity is noted at the anterior superior labrum, suggesting a mild degenerative tear. Now, let's scroll down again, looking carefully at the inferior capsule. In adhesive capsulitis, this area typically shows thickening and increased signal intensity, but in this case, it appears relatively normal. It is my interpretation of his medical record, there is a bursal-sided footprint tear at the far anterior portion of the supraspinatus tendon. However, it cannot be confirmed that this tear is the direct cause of his pain. More importantly, there are signs of injury to the coracohumeral ligament, along with chronic subacromial impingement and a tendinous degeneration process. Additionally, there appears to be early or subtle involvement around the inferior capsule, suggesting that something may be progressing in that region as well. Let's talk about the passive range of motion test, specifically for the glenohumeral joint. This test is essential in shoulder evaluation, especially when trying to detect adhesive capsulitis or discriminate it from symptomatic calcification or other cuff pathologies. Now, many clinicians perform active or passive shoulder flexion and assume they're assessing the whole joint, but there's a problem. These tests have a blind spot. Why? Because flexion movements allow for scapular compensation, even when the glenohumeral joint is stiff, patients can still lift their arms by using scapulothoracic motion. As a result, flexion may appear to be improved or normal, when in fact, the true glenohumeral motion is still limited. This can easily lead to a misinterpretation, giving the impression that shoulder motion is preserved, when it's not. That's why passive flexion alone is not sensitive enough to detect early or subtle capsular restriction in the glenohumeral joint. So in this test, the goal is to isolate the glenohumeral joint, and to do that, scapular motion must be excluded. How? By using manual fixation. One needs to firmly block the scapula, especially the inferior angle, using a hand or fingers. This prevents the scapula from rotating and compensating during the test. Then, using the other hand, controlled passive movement of the shoulder is performed, whether it's abduction, external rotation, or internal rotation. Here's how it's performed in the clinic. Bare hands are used, no tools. What is focused on? First, the angle of movement, how much true motion is available before resistance. Second, the patient's response, including facial expression, muscle guarding, and any pain response. Third, the end feel felt through the fingertips. As the shoulder is gently moved, one is not just measuring angles, one is listening with their hands. A soft, elastic end feel might indicate muscular limitation or pain guarding. It is crucial to feel what stops the motion. Is it soft, like muscle? Is it elastic, like tendon tension? Or is it bony hard, like joint capsule stiffness or early fibrosis? In cases of adhesive capsulitis, a firm, mechanical end feel will be noticed, especially in external rotation, often long before MRI shows any clear abnormalities. So, again, PROM testing, done properly, is one of the most specific and revealing methods to detect early glenohumeral joint dysfunction and to differentiate between adhesive capsulitis and other conditions. But it only works if done with focus, fix the scapula, isolate the glenohumeral joint, and feel the joint's true behavior through the hands. Now, let me explain how to perform the passive range of motion test of the glenohumeral joint using the method employed in daily practice with the patient seated upright on a stool. When the patient is sitting, they should be relaxed, feet on the floor, arms hanging naturally. This position allows full access to the shoulder joint and, more importantly, provides control to manually fix the scapula, which is essential. We're not just observing general shoulder movement, we're isolating true glenohumeral motion. To accurately assess the glenohumeral joint, scapular compensation must be blocked. One hand palpates and fixes the inferior angle of the scapula from behind, while the other hand moves the arm through each motion. It is critical to feel, in real time, when the scapula starts to move. That's where true glenohumeral motion ends. Let's start with passive abduction. The patient's elbow is kept flexed at 90 degrees, and the arm is slowly raised in the coronal plane. The hand under the scapula senses the first moment of upward scapular rotation, and that's where the movement is stopped. The angle is recorded, any painful response is observed, and the quality of the end point is felt. Next, passive external rotation is tested at about 45 degrees of abduction. The elbow is kept at 90 degrees, forearm vertical. With one hand, the acromion and lateral clavicle are firmly stabilized, blocking scapular rotation. With the other hand, the forearm is gently rotated outward. Again, the movement is stopped as soon as resistance is felt, before the scapula shifts. In adhesive capsulitis, this motion is usually the most limited, and a firm, bony or leathery end feel will be observed. Then comes passive internal rotation in the same position. The forearm is rotated inward, toward the body, while keeping the scapula fixed. Internal rotation is often less restricted than external rotation, but still limited in adhesive capsulitis. The patient's face is watched, guarding or pain is observed, and the end feel is carefully assessed. Now let me emphasize this: when this test is performed properly, one is not just measuring range, one is listening through their hands. One is feeling the joint's resistance. A soft or springy end point may indicate muscular limitation or pain guarding. But when a bony hard stop is felt, with no elasticity, that's a classic sign of capsular stiffness. This is often the only way to detect early adhesive capsulitis, even before MRI shows anything obvious. So again, passive range of motion testing is essential, and it must be done meticulously. Fix the scapula. Isolate the glenohumeral joint. Use your hand to feel the angle, observe the pain response, and assess the end feel. Because this is the most specific, and sometimes the last, method available to identify adhesive capsulitis and to differentiate it from symptomatic calcification or a cuff tear. This is my conclusion of the case discussion. Currently, the patient is suffering from adhesive capsulitis, even though the MRI shows an insertional footprint tear at the far anterior supraspinatus. My treatment strategy is focused on relieving pain and restoring range of motion, rather than addressing the tear surgically at this stage. Thank you for watching. It is my honor to be with you. As esteemed premium members, your support greatly motivates my journey of practical pain management on YouTube. I look forward to seeing you in the upcoming videos.